I have to ask, is this shock and awe? You're not seeing it.
In the last 10 years of unbridled corporate globalization, the world's total income has increased by an average of 2.5% a year. And yet, the number of poor in the world has increased by 100 million. Of the top 100 biggest economies, 51 are corporations, not countries. The top 1% of the world has the same combined income as the bottom 57%. And that disparity is growing. And now, under the spreading canopy of the war against terror, this process is being hustled along. The men in suits are in an unseemly hurry. While bombs rain down on us and cruise missiles skid across the skies, while nuclear weapons are stockpiled to make the world a safer place. Contracts are being signed, patents are being registered, oil pipelines are being laid, natural resources are being plundered, water is being privatized, and democracies are being undermined.
A key element of the U.S. grand strategy today is to obtain further penetration, further control, and further exploitation of the third world. I call it globalization at gunpoint.
The Economist called the new rules in Iraq a capitalist dream and described the rules that Paul Bremer, the chief U.S. occupier in Iraq, as a wish list for foreign multinationals. This wish list, which was granted as part of the now infamous Order 39, which was on September 19th, was a transformation of the Iraqi economy, using basically traditional IMF structural adjustment policies, but in one fell swoop. So Order 39 announced that, contrary to Iraq's constitution, which places clear restrictions on foreign ownership of the Iraqi economy and deems essential services protected and not able to be privatized, these were just completely overthrown. And 200 Iraqi state firms were put up for privatization.
This means giving the United States greater access to markets, labor, and resources across the third world. This is explicitly spelled out in the Bush September 2002 National Security Strategy, which calls for spreading free trade and free markets across the globe. And of course, this is code for the freedom of U.S. capital in particular to exploit those countries and region. They have been trying to put it into effect in Iraq. 2 months before the Governing Council was even formed, in May 2003, shortly after the U.S. invasion, the Wall Street Journal obtained a 100-page document detailing how the U.S. intended to create an economy in its own, quote, image.
What's starting to happen is that international legal experts are coming forward, not from the left, but from international conservative law firms to say these contracts are extremely risky and they won't be respected. The only legal way out of this bind is the U.S. has to get a regime in Iraq quickly that's pliant enough to ratify the laws. That's the only way that they can make them legal.
It is illegal, and Paul Bremer has gone on record since September of last year as telling us he wants to restructure Iraqi economy. He's not mincing his words on that. He wants to restructure the Iraqi economy, and he has been doing that by removing tariffs from Iraq, removing all domestic subsidies, by imposing a maximum flat tax of 15%, with loopholes so big Halliburton can go right through, and by, most importantly, coming up with an order that allows, you know, foreign corporations to own 100% of any Iraqi sector with the exception of oil, and then on top of that to remove 100% of their profits out of Iraq without delay at any time. And these laws have been reimposed, you know, this year, 2004. It's not simply laws that were passed in 2003. They've been reimposed. And there's been numerous other things, such as recently, you know, in the beginning of April and in the end of March, we have seen Paul Bremer impose laws that will strip the current Iraqi government governmental ministries and possible future Iraqi governmental ministries of their ability to change the contracts that Bremer has given out to U.S. corporations and to change the economic structuring that Paul Bremer has imposed on Iraq over the past year. So he's stripping away future sovereignty of Iraq, not only present sovereignty.
One of the main reasons the U.S. felt compelled to go to war against Iraq in 2003 was that sanctions were on the verge of collapse. If sanctions had collapsed, massive multi-billion dollar oil deals that Saddam Hussein had signed with France and Russia would have come to fruition. It would have left France and Russia in a stronger position in Iraq than the United States, with a toehold into the Persian Gulf. And of course, this was coming at a time when the U.S. strategy has been to brook no rivals and to prevent the rise of any imperial challengers.
I think that it explains the silence of Germany, Russia, China. What they're waiting to see is whether Bremer is going to respect the contracts that Saddam Hussein signed with Russian, Chinese, and French companies. If my sense is that if they will respect it, you know, there have been noises being made that they're not going to respect contracts signed by Saddam Hussein. And my feeling is that if they do go down that route, then you'll start hearing a lot of noise from Russia, France, China, Germany, the countries that whose companies were in there and had those deals. Right now, I think what we're seeing is actually some pretty heavy backroom negotiating. And I think the deal that's being made, frankly, is if you respect the contracts that we signed with Saddam Hussein, then we'll which you could also make an argument were illegal, we will respect the contracts, your equally illegal contracts being signed by the occupational authority. And I think that the position of a genuine anti-occupation movement should be that neither should be respected, that any new free sovereign Iraqi government should not be saddled either with the debts and contracts of their dictator or of their occupier.
Probably billions on selling their weapons. It's war profiteering.
Yeah.
It's insider trading, having top, you know, ex-government officials get these defense industry contracts and profiting off of the death and destruction of people in Iraq and all over the world. Because we're putting out a message to all war profiteers: if you think you're going to make profits off the debt of the Iraqi people, whether it's Carlyle Group, Halliburton, Bechtel, you are put on notice. We are going to expose you, and we are going to make it as difficult as hell for you to stay open.
Companies like Bechtel and Halliburton definitely play an important role in influencing foreign policy and defense policy, or you could say offense policy in the United States. The federal government consults with these companies before they go to war, and so determines the nature of the war. So for example, in October of 2002, the federal government, Dick Cheney's office, met with a bunch of companies, including Halliburton and ExxonMobil and Chevron Texaco, to talk about how they would take over the Iraqi oil fields. undoubtedly they looked to profit from it, and they definitely steered the way the war was conducted in their private meetings with Dick Cheney and the U.S. administration.
Operation Iraqi Freedom, George Bush assures us, is about returning Iraqi oil to the Iraqi people. That is, returning Iraqi oil to the Iraqi people via corporate multinationals like Bechtel, like Chevron, like Halliburton. Once again, it's a small, tight circle that connects corporate, military, and government leadership to one another. The promiscuousness, the cross-pollination, is outrageous.
I've worked in almost every aspect of investment banking, and lately I've been concentrating mostly on fund management. And for me, it's natural to understand the implications of privatization to the Iraqi public, what it would create. And it's very important that the United States corrects its track as quickly as possible. I mean, one of the very ominous signs is that there has been appointed an American to be in charge of the privatization program of Iraq. This is completely uncalled for. When we put this combined with the attempt to push through the governing council a law which permits international companies to have unlimited ownership in Iraq, it's very clear what the designs are. Wholesale ownership by foreign companies, and Iraqis will end up being employees of foreign firms. And this is totally unacceptable. I consider this as an economist, economic imperialism.
I think initially when the U.S. military and the U.S. administration decided to occupy Iraq, they had these plans for a free market democracy, as they would call it. This is a country with a great deal of wealth. It had a lot of oil. It's the perfect place to test a free market. A free market is not going to really work in a place where people don't buy goods from. I mean, in Afghanistan, for example, doesn't have a lot of goods except opium. And so you can't really test a free market. Whereas here, you could have a flat tax, you could open up the borders, have no taxes, and it could prove that free trade worked. So they had these grand plans. They wanted to privatize. And in fact, the first overseer of Iraq, Jay Garner, didn't think that would work. He had some experience in the country, having worked in Kurdistan, and he was opposed to privatization. And so for those reasons, among others, he was fired from his job and replaced by Paul Bremer, who went right ahead and set up a couple of different laws, one that especially looked at the privatization of everything Iraqi, except the oil resources. And the oil resources are seen as sacrosanct because that's the mainstay of Iraqi wealth. And Iraqis would be very upset if that was wholly turned over to a foreign company. So that clearly was off the table. However, the rest of it didn't actually work either.
There's a tender which is about to be decided on 5th of September for the mobile telecom in Iraq. The tender calls for three companies to start operating in three areas of Iraq: north, central, and southern Iraq. The conditions for the tender are such that it makes it impossible for an Iraqi company to be doing this, because it requires that the companies that enter the bids should be experienced. They should have experience in more than one country. And since Iraq is in a state of just coming out of a war, naturally there is no such company in Iraq.
The tender for the Iraqi cell phones went to a company from Egypt called Rascom, which set up the first new Iraqna mobile system that functions only in Baghdad right now. There's been a lot of rumors that the company that got it because of their links to members of the governing council, and that there was some hanky-panky, that was going on, in which members of the American administration
occupying Iraq were trying to steer the contract to certain friends of theirs, which in fact failed, but spoke volumes as to how they were doing business.
So obviously they're putting very high walls for Iraqis to climb. It's a very, very much not a level playing field. You know, we're being taken for a ride.
It's important to understand that even if every troop were to come home tomorrow and a so-called sovereign Iraqi government were to come into power, Iraq would still be privatized. It would be privatized by these laws that were written by another country. It would be privatized by foreign companies that would be controlling their essential services. And it would be colonized by the fact that they now have 70% unemployment because of attacks on the public sector. That is colonization.
Capitalist globalization, as I mentioned, has led to large-scale turmoil, upheaval, dramatic social change, and political instability throughout the Third World. And so the U.S. is seeking new forms of control, new ways to try to stabilize that situation. And we're seeing this played out in Iraq with U.S. efforts to create a pro-U.S. neo-colony, much more directly controlled by the United States than Saddam Hussein's government ever was. But we are also seeing the potential pitfalls and dangers of this in the kind of explosive resistance we're seeing in the streets of Iraq today. This whole grand strategy, mapping out this grand strategy, is one thing, but accomplishing it is another. And the history I trace in my book shows that these grand schemes of empire often backfire, create unintended effects, and generate even greater resistance than existed before.
The free market privatization plan has basically failed. And despite the fact that the neocons and the people in the U.S. administration thought that Iraq would be the perfect place to do the experiment, presumably people would want to invest because it is potentially very wealthy, second largest reserves of oil in the world. However, when they arrived, they discovered the oil infrastructure was in very bad shape, in no small part because of the sanctions. And therefore, they weren't able to export the kind of oil to bring in the kind of income they were expecting. So they didn't have the money. The second thing is Saddam Hussein had basically employed pretty much everybody to work in the ministries and the companies and the fields and that sort of thing. They got very minimal wages, but they all had a job, despite of whether they did work or not. So when some of the managers of these institutions came along, they were like, well, we could make ourselves a lot more efficient, we could get rid of these surplus workers, and we could actually maybe getting some international investment that was lacking for the last 10 to 20 years because of sanctions and various other things. So one daring fellow who ran, I believe, a vegetable oil company suggested that he would go first and experiment. So he fired his surplus workers and invited foreign investment. But then something he didn't expect happened. His workers, who no longer had a job, were pretty upset, so they came back and they killed him. And as a result, this whole sort of privatization scheme collapsed. And when the American government realized this was happening, they put all their privatization plans on hold. The next thing that happened was they realized that a lot of these laws they'd enacted in order to allow everything to be privatized, Paul Bremer suggested, actually passed a resolution that would, or an executive order that would have allowed the privatization of every sector, was basically discovered to be illegal under international law. Now, this was way back in December. Subsequently, in March and April, because of the incredibly bad judgment and bad planning on parts of the military, as the resistance started to rise, the security situation deteriorated, and as a result, nobody wants to go into Iraq to set up a business because it's too dangerous, and there's no guarantee that their business will continue to exist. That's not to say that people don't work in Iraq. Plenty of companies work in Iraq, but only if they have money from the U.S. government or they have guarantees that their businesses will not be nationalized in the future or ransacked. And that, again, once again, mostly comes from foreign governments.
What's happening is that somebody needs to insure these companies to go into a very risky situation. So the U.S. Import-Export Bank is being presented, being put forward as the insurer of last resort, which means that they would offer insurance to, say, a Bechtel to come in and privatize the water in Iraq. But then if a new Iraqi government then decides to renationalize that asset, it would be the U.S. taxpayers, not Bechtel, that would be on the hook. So the U.S. taxpayers not only pay with their $87 billion in terms of bankrolling this reconstruction boondoggle, but they will then have to potentially pay again when it becomes clear that these contracts were illegal to begin with.
You see a lot of propaganda in the U.S. media. A lot of talk about democracy and new interim constitution, the governing council, how people are welcoming the U.S. troops. This is all false. The Union of the Unemployed was an answer to the situation, and it was brought up from among the ranks of unemployed workers. The main demand of the Union of the Unemployed was to provide unemployment benefit to the unemployed workers. That's the only demand. Of course, we demanded the immediate providing of jobs to the Iraqi workers.
We want jobs. We want jobs. 3 out of 4 Iraqis, according to the International Monetary Fund, don't have a job. This is a huge, huge problem, and is sowing a lot of resentment. The fact that people see these American occupiers, the soldiers, and they also see foreign workers coming and doing those jobs that they would like to do. And a lot of things that people are being imported for, whether it's truck driving or cooking, are jobs that people in any country can do, and most certainly they can do in Iraq. Iraq has very sophisticated doctors and civil engineers too. Many of those people were fired because they were seen to be Ba'athist. Now, given that 10% of the population was a member of the Ba'ath Party, it has created many problems, especially since in order to rise within the ranks, you had to be a member of the Ba'ath Party. As a result, every experienced doctor, teacher, engineer is now out of work. And as a result, things are not functioning very well because most people have no idea where the equipment is or the services are.
Since the 40s, the working movement in Iraq have been active. Thousands get to the streets, thousands clash with the police. Many hundreds of workers have been martyrs to the working class movement in Iraq. So these achievements are not Saddam's achievements. These achievements are the workers' achievements. Now they are attacking these achievements with the help of the U.S., with the help of Paul Bremer. They want to falsify the cause of Iraqi workers. But they don't know that there are independent workers who would organize their own workers, and we succeeded in that. This demonstration was organized by the UUI, Union of Unemployed in Iraq. It started at the headquarters of the union, which was at the end of Rashid Street, near Tahrir Square. It crossed the bridge, Al-Jamhuriya Bridge, and approached the CPA headquarters, which was the presidential palace, Al-Qasr al-Jamhuri. And there we shouted slogans that demanded jobs or social benefits for all unemployed people in Iraq.
A lot of the services have not been fully restored. So in Baghdad, 50% of the time, there's no electricity. Now, Iraq was a very modern economy with, you know, completely functional electricity before the first Gulf War, with good hospitals, good education system, and all of this was for pretty much free. So most of the stuff no longer functions. The sewage plants that were bombed by the Americans in the first Gulf War continue to be inoperable, and therefore the water for Iraqis is polluted. So that's a major deterioration of the quality of life. Children's playgrounds are empty and abandoned. The main park in Baghdad is unused. Even under Saddam Hussein's time, people went and played there, and that no longer happens. The restaurants and the cafes along the river, those have closed down, partly because the Americans have barricaded those areas because they're worried about, you know, attacks from the river, partly because, you know, people really don't want to go out. The movie theaters are pretty much, if not entirely, shut down. The quality of life has definitely deteriorated, especially where, you know, public life, just community life is concerned, those things have disappeared.
Under Saddam and his clique, there were a few people who were beneficiaries, and the majority of Iraqis simply were spectators. We are creating now the same circumstance. The Iraqi public at large are spectators. There is a small clique who are beneficiaries, along with the international companies. So where is the real change in terms of economics? Where is the real change? If the peace dividend is going to accrue to international companies, then I'm sorry to say this is a formula which is unfair, and I think in the long run it's a formula for disaster.
وما لي